rear camber adjustment arms installation on a 2004 Chrysler Crossfire. As you can see here, the left rear tire is out of adjustment, and it's the rear camber arms that are to blame. This tire is not out of balance, and it is wearing through the tread on the inside of the tire. We're going to repair this with the adjustable rear camber arms, both left and right, driver's side and passenger side. The installation is fairly easy and only requires a few tools. The tools required here to do the job are an 18 millimeter wrench. This in the form of a socket and ratchet. A 19 millimeter wrench. This in the form of a 3/4 inch wrench. A 24 millimeter wrench. This in the form of a socket and ratchet. We have here a Torx screwdriver, and the co-star of the whole event, a T55 Torx socket and ratchet on 3/8 inch drive. I'm not sure if I'm going to get enough torque on this 3/8 inch drive, and it may require a breakover bar in order to break the previous suspension arms free. Some secondary items that you might want to include would be some screwdrivers to pry with, a hammer to bang on some stuff with, a treble light, and a battery light for being underneath the vehicle. Those are the stars of the show up there on top, the adjustable camber arms, and some other items you may want to include. I built these myself, a platform to pull the car up on so you get an extra couple inches underneath the vehicle. I'm a fairly large man, about 6'3", and getting underneath the vehicle of this height, or limited height, can be kind of a pain in the neck. I also included some gloves in order to work with the dirty parts. Let's get the car jacked up and get underneath it. This is the arm that we're going to be replacing. I've got an additional floor jack underneath the differential of the vehicle, because I don't trust this jack here. There's not a lot of points in which you can jack or put a jack stand underneath this car, so that's something to consider while you're working underneath it. You'll want to work quickly. You want to be aware of your surroundings so you don't injure yourself, push the vehicle off the jack, or anything silly like that. Working on the top of the arm at the moment. This is the 3/4 inch wrench, standing in for the 19 millimeter. It's coming relatively easily. I'll cut to the next step. Well, I remove this. Here, I want you to see this. I've got a 3/4 inch socket on the back of the suspension, to the top suspension arm, and I'm using this 3/4 inch wrench to finish off removing the top of this arm. Once it's broken free, you should be able to almost finger unthread it. It's a little difficult to see there, I think, but I think you can see me unthreading the top arm and pulling the bolt through.
little hard to do with the camera in the way. There we go. Okay. I'll now work on breaking the other end free. Wanted to show you something here before we get too deeply involved in this. On the back side of this upper A-arm, the Torx side is over here, and there's an 18 millimeter nut on the back of it. This is problematic because if you can see just to the right of it here, there's an additional swing arm. Sorry about the shaky camera work. There's an additional swing arm right here, and it's too close to the nut. We're going to need an open-end wrench to get in there on it. Earlier I said an 18 millimeter socket. That's clearly out the door now. We're going to need to move on to the open-end 18 millimeter wrench. I'll be back as soon as I get this knocked free. Okay, at this point I've got the open-end 18 millimeter wrench on the front of the suspension arm and a Torx 55T attached to the back of the suspension arm. And once you have that in place, you can bridge this 18 millimeter wrench into place, and then all you have to do is use the ratchet, and it will eventually come undone, but boy, it's a lot of work. So you just got to keep torquing on it, and you only really get about a quarter of a turn at a time. Eventually you'll be able to get it out of there. Quick tip, I took the top of the suspension arm off first. I slid that bolt back in to keep it into place. When I do the other side, I'm thinking that I will probably go ahead and unbolt that first because it's the easiest to get to, but I will leave that bolt in place until the suspension arm closest to the wheel has been removed. Be real careful because you can kind of torque this back plate fairly good on the back side of your rotor here. So be careful about that. I am using gloves. There are some sharp edges back here, and I'm trying not to cut up my hands. I'll show you when I get this off. Okay, I now have the suspension arm removed. You can see how there's no adjustment to it. It does look like it may be bent up a little bit, maybe from my trip to Alaska. It does have this natural arch to it here that is put into it. But the new suspension arm will be going into its place. The thing you want to do is line up the tops and bottoms of the holes, make sure they're at the same distance, and then put the new suspension arm back into place. Hey, I wanted to show you something here. The ends on the new suspension rods are not as wide at the ends as the originals. That could create a real problem when it's moving back and forth inside the mount at the back of the car. So I've got a fender washer that I've put in place, and you can see that right over here. Do you see it in there, the front of the vehicle? Right there. There it is. That's a brand new washer. Okay, working on the driver's side top suspension stabilizer. This one is the unadjustable here. I have removed everything that needs to be removed. This is the bolt that goes on the top. Excuse me, I'm sorry, it goes this way. And attaches with this nut, obviously. We've got two things we use here. A 3/4 inch socket and wrench. In front, this bolt. It's a little bit trickier. If you notice in the end, it's got a Torx 55T here, coming in this direction. And then an 18 millimeter opened end wrench coming at it from this direction. And that will be just behind this flange or piece of tin behind the rotor. Okay, driver's side finished at this point. There you can see the suspension arm with the nut towards the front and the additional washer in place. I come around the side here, maybe you'll see from the top. There you go. That's the suspension arm next to the rotor right there. I want to point out something that I didn't point out on the other one. You want to make sure this flat spot on the suspension arm center area here, this flat spot needs to be towards your rotor. This is so they can adjust it with a couple of adjustable wrenches. Tighten or loosen the entire suspension arm. This is, of course, the whole purpose of this project for today. Oh man, what a disaster. Look at that driver's side tire. All on the inside, right down to the radial steel. So you can see that. There it is, right there. This is from not having adjustable camber arms. After the suspension has been beat up a little bit over time. Vehicle is 10 years old now. They need to be able to adjust the camber in or out to make it so the tire doesn't wear funny like this. Here we are back at the back of the vehicle. As you can see here, no noticeable change in ride height. It's important to make sure when you put the adjustable camber arms in place of the stock suspension arms that you make sure that the holes line up. That way there is no change in ride height and no strange cambering. As you can see here, it still has the old tires on it, so I'm going to head over and get a new pair of rear tires for the Crossfire. I would call this a success. I'll let you guys know if there's any unusual noises or knocking coming from the rear suspension. And this pretty much wraps this up.